TGA COVID-19 weekly safety report. Okay, this is as of today, the 19th of the 8th. Now, these events were not necessarily caused by the vaccine disclosure, all right? So when we talk about adverse events or deaths following immunization, we're not saying that, we're not trying to state beyond doubt that it was the vaccine that caused those deaths or adverse reactions. Rather, those deaths and adverse reactions occurred after somebody took a vaccine. All right, so what are we up to now? This is what the TGA is reporting. 460 deaths post vaccination and 50,597 total AEFIs. Again, that stands for adverse event following immunization. Just going to read to you a little disclaimer here. Records of death / AEFIs that occurred post COVID-19 vaccination administration do not necessarily indicate true cause of death / AEFI, nor do they necessarily indicate the true number of deaths / AEFIs that occurred shortly after administration. Does that all make sense, ladies and gentlemen? We don't want to be putting data out there that can be misinterpreted. Here at MCJ Report, unlike the mainstream media and unlike the government, we like to paint a proper picture of what's going on, not one that can be easily misinterpreted. All right, so what do we have here? First of all, it's really important to understand what is classified to be an adverse event following immunization. Some people may claim that it's only an adverse event if it's serious. That's not actually true. If we look at the definition from the World Health Organization, it goes as follows. An adverse event following immunization, AEFI, is any untoward medical occurrence which follows immunization and which does not necessarily have a causal relationship with the usage of the vaccine. The adverse event may be any unfavorable or unintended sign, abnormal laboratory finding, symptom, or disease. Okay, so notice there's no reference to severity. That means that an adverse event could be something that is very severe or something that is not severe at all. For instance, maybe a bit of a headache. That could be considered an adverse event following immunization based on the classification from the World Health Organization, which is supposed to be the classification that we follow here in Australia. So as you see there, the source, and I'll send this out to you, is directly from the World Health Organization, Module 3, Adverse Events Following Immunization. Go ahead and join our newsletter, mcjreport.com, and I'll send you the documentation out so you can be sure that you're familiar with this definition, because definitions are really, really important when we're talking about this sort of stuff. All right, let's have a look here. This is from the Therapeutic Goods Administration. I'm just going to read through it here. So what we see is 3.3 reports per 1,000 doses, 50,597 total AEFI reports received, and 15,341,039 total doses administered. Now, I personally take some exception to how these weekly safety reports are published, and I'm going to tell you why. Here are a couple of notes that I made. One, most people are capable of basic mathematical interpretation. Two, the above data could potentially be misinterpreted. Okay, so why exactly am I saying this? I'm saying this because if you were to look at the total AEFIs reported directly next to the total doses administered, one could perhaps easily misinterpret this figure of 50,500 as the actual figure of adverse events, not realizing that many adverse events may not have been reported to the TGA, or maybe they were reported but have not been received. I'm going to expand on that a little bit more. We really have to get into the nitty-gritty of these weekly safety reports because, in my view, they're not comprehensive. All right, so let's take a little bit of a look here. My opinion. Now, just to reiterate, this is 100% my opinion and my interpretation of these figures / how they could be interpreted. You are more than welcome to disagree with me. If you think I'm wrong, go ahead and put it in the comments, all right? This is, once again, I just want to reiterate, this is my opinion and my opinion alone. 3.3 reports per 1,000 doses represents a reporting rate of 0.33%, which, if incorrectly interpreted, could paint a picture of an unrealistically low AEFI rate. Okay, maybe you agree with that opinion. Maybe you don't. Put your thoughts in the comments. As of the 16th of the 8th, OSVAC Safety, which is government funded, which is an entity that communicates with the TGA, just so you know, reported that out of 2,407,369 survey participants, 45.7% reported experiencing an adverse event post-vaccination, or in other words, an AEFI. Based on OSVAC safety reporting data, and considering that many people have been administered two doses, one could reasonably estimate the total number of AEFIs to be approximately 7,010,855. Again, this is my opinion, and I'm basing my opinion on the data produced by OSVAC Safety, nearly 2.5 million survey respondents. So I figure that data set is probably somewhat reliable. If you are following me, just put that in the comments, because I really want to make sure that this is all quite easy to understand. So what is my basic conclusion after looking at the information published here? My conclusion is that, quote, these are my words, again, my opinion, the TGA COVID-19 Vaccine Weekly Safety Report is not comprehensive and can be easily misinterpreted. That's my opinion, that's my view, and I'm sticking to it for now. So I've got my sources here, the TGA and also the OSVAC Safety website. Again, mcjreport.com. Head on over there, put your email address in, and I'll send you these resources tomorrow. All right, this raises a couple of questions. The first question is, why is the safety report not comprehensive? What do I mean by not comprehensive? I mean, they don't even bother to advise readers that there could be more adverse events that haven't been recorded. They don't bother to advise readers on the survey results of OSVAC Safety. They don't bother to advise readers on a breakdown, say, between gender, age groups, the proportion of adverse reactions depending on how people were affected and so forth. All right, that's the first question right there. Second, given the 45.7 rate of AEFI published by OSVAC Safety, why is the TGA not making more of an effort to collect AEFI data? Okay, it seems that there's so many people responding to this survey. So what is it with the TGA? Are they understaffed, or could it possibly be something else? Another question that I have, why is the AEFI reporting rate so low, 0.33%? I don't have the answer to that question. Is it because doctors or other health institutions are not reporting in the numbers that they should, or is it that they are reporting but the TGA is unable to process the reports? I don't have the answer to these questions. It's probably a question that somebody in Parliament should ask the Health Minister Greg Hunt, because he's supposed to know this stuff. All right, so let's just take a look at the website right here. I want to show you a couple of things from the safety report, and I'd like to get your opinion on it. All right, so first of all, I just wanted to point out that in the safety report, the very first paragraph is a paragraph that is designed to reiterate the importance of taking the COVID-19 vaccine. Now, when I look at a safety report, I don't want really any additional information. I want to know what the figures are so I can take those figures and make up my own mind and hopefully not misinterpret the figures, okay? So anyway, I just wanted to point that out as point number one. When we look down here, we see that the first dot point is in relation to the doses administered, 15.3 million vaccine doses. That reference is made 3 times in the vaccine safety report. When we move down the page here, I'm going to talk a little bit about deaths. Since the beginning of the vaccine rollout to 15th of August 2021, I'm reading here, 15.3 million doses, there you go, they say it again, of COVID-19 vaccines have been given. So far, the TGA has found that 7 reports of death were linked to immunization from 460 reports received and reviewed. Okay, so 460 reports of death have been received and reviewed, and out of those 460, the TGA have said that they found that 7 reports of those deaths were linked to immunization. Okay, so a very, very small figure based on the TGA weekly safety report. It says here, these deaths occurred after the first dose of the AstraZeneca vaccine. All right, so we move down here. Of course, this is the chart that I showed you just before. If you were to look at the total AEFIs received, right next to the total doses administered, you would be forgiven for drawing the conclusion that there is an extremely low rate of total adverse events. Okay, you'd be totally excused for making that mathematical determination in your own mind. So what do you think? Put your thoughts in the comments. Here's something else that's really interesting to take note of. Look at this. Previously de-identified reports were made publicly available in the database of adverse event notifications, DANE database, 90 days after they were completed by staff at the TGA. All right, so actually, it was until just a couple of days ago, the data produced from DANE's, the database of adverse event notifications, was 90 days old. Okay, in saying that, the total adverse events reports received, published by the Therapeutic Goods Administration, was up to date. But if you wanted to conduct a search to find out specifically what were the adverse events from the past 90 days, you would not have had access to that information. Okay, so TGA has now officially changed that policy to reduce the lag time to 14 days after reports are supposedly accepted. So there's been a reduction from 90 days all the way down to 14 days. So what does that mean? It means that more than 30,000 additional adverse event reports are now visible in the DANE database. Okay, so we're going to talk about that a little bit more as well. Okay, so the main takeaways that we have here is that we see, I think that we see a major discrepancy. So the question we need to be asking ourselves is, once again, what would a more realistic estimation be of adverse events following immunizations be? What would that possibly be? All right, so we're going to move along here to just, I'm just gonna show you the references that we used. I hope that this is all making sense and that it's not appearing to be all over the place. This is the AusVax safety website. And this right here is the database of adverse event notifications from the Therapeutic Goods Administration. It's not very user-friendly. I tried to use it before, it stalled. And as I said before, the information, the adverse event information will now only have a lag time of 14 days. Those are reports that have been supposedly received and reviewed by the TGA. 14 days down from 90. So what are we doing about this? We are doing something about this, I can tell you. The major objection I have to the TGA weekly safety report is that it's not comprehensive, and in my view, it provides ample scope for misinterpretation and for people to potentially underestimate the likelihood of experiencing some sort of adverse event following immunization. So I mentioned this to you on maybe an MCJ report a couple of episodes ago, and that is that we have a team of data analysts and they are dissecting the data from the DANE database. That's right. So we're looking into this data and producing different metrics in order to provide a more comprehensive interpretation of the data held by the TGA, so that hopefully at the end of the day, vaccine consumers or would-be vaccine consumers can make a better informed decision. Because in my view, the government is not playing any role in helping people to make an informed decision. When was the last time, for example, that you saw somebody like Greg Hunt or Daniel Andrews, Brett Sutton, or Scott Morrison encourage the public or encourage health practitioners to report adverse events to the Therapeutic Goods Administration? In my view, they really don't advertise it. We hear about all the restrictions, we hear about all the so-called cases, but we don't hear public calls calling on the public to submit information regarding adverse events. Why do you think that is? Why do you think they seem to be silent on that? I don't have the answer to that question, but we're working on it. So I have a little bit of a teaser for you regarding some of the information. Now, this information, this data, is from the DANE database, but it has been ordered in a format to be easily understood by the general public. Now, if you have questions regarding adverse events following immunization and you try to conduct your own searches via the DANE database, I can tell you it's not easy to navigate. It's not user-friendly and it doesn't provide the type of graphics which I say would be of any use to an average person simply looking to interpret the data. So the closest sort of graphics that we've seen produced has been from AusVax Safety, and it's basically limited to this type of thing right here. A basic pie chart in relation to adverse events, one dose, two doses, and so forth. So what do we have here? I'll show you a little bit of a preview regarding data that we will be regularly publishing on the MCJ report because the government refuses to publish it. Okay, so I'm just going to move out of the way here. So this is data as of the 13th of May this year. Why are we looking so far in the past? Well, it's because until recently, we only had access to data that had been published after 3 months. That's right, there was a 3 month delay. And now that it's recently changed, our team of data analysts will be very busy pulling this data out to reproduce this type of visual information. So what do we see here? Data of the 13th of the 5th. Report entry date, 21st of February to 13th of May. Total cases of adverse reactions at that time. So adverse reactions that had been, quote, received and reviewed by the Therapeutic Goods Administration, 17,475. All right, so what we have here is something that's not provided in the weekly safety report, which is very basic thing, a breakdown of gender and age. So what we see here when looking at gender, sorry, I just have to lean in a little bit. We see female, 76%, and we see male, 26%, and then a small percentage not specified. I had to lean in there a little bit because I couldn't read on the screen. Now, first of all, I don't want anyone to jump to any conclusions. This is data as of the 13th of the 5th. The data has definitely changed, okay? So please look at this through terms of the 13th of May. All right, so why is it that we see a very high portion of female versus male in relation to adverse reactions? So the answer to that question, I can't actually give you because the data is inconclusive, okay? It could be completely random that it just so happened that more reports were received and reviewed from people who happen to be female, not male. It could be for whatever reason, perhaps females are more likely to have reports sent in to the Therapeutic Goods Administration. So this pie chart alone does not demonstrate whether or not females are more likely to experience an adverse event following immunization. I just want to make that perfectly clear because I don't want to misinform someone. It could potentially mean that, but there's really no way we can prove it. Okay, we also see on the other column here, age and a breakdown of adverse events following immunization in relation to age. So we see the highest group there, 50 to 65 years, which at the time came in at 3,873 adverse events following immunization that had been received and reviewed by the TGA. Once again, of course, I'm not trying to say that it is without any doubt the vaccines caused this. We don't know. It could have been completely unrelated, and it could also be just some type of anomaly that at the time, the highest age bracket of reports that had been reviewed were people aged between 50 and 65 years old. Okay, so this is the type of data that our team is working on. So we're extremely grateful, and we're going to be publishing this data weekly on the MCJ report at mcjreport.com. We're going to be publishing it in written form, and we're also going to be talking about it on the show. This is going to be a permanent fixture of the MCJ report. As I said before, my concern is that the TGA weekly safety report is not comprehensive and does not allow would-be vaccine consumers to make a proper informed decision. It should be the government's job to produce this data. They're not doing it. So we the people, we the citizens, we are doing it.